Hi, and welcome to Telepathic TV. This is television that you watch with your third eye. And as always, I'm R. Neville Johnston.
And I'm Mary Phelan, and our program is about raising our consciousness. And tonight we're going to talk about living a life in tune as opposed to out of tune. And so much of our life is out of tune.
Yeah, and very easily so. We're trained from the earliest years to be out of tune. In fact, being out of tune will guarantee you to get the most valuable thing on earth. Mm-hmm. Human attention.
Well, you can't really play a good song on a piano that's out of tune, so how can we live our life? And you're right, the human attention
is interesting. Yeah, we're trained to be out of tune. It's an absurd notion. Mm-hmm. And being in tune, being the child that's the one that does not require fixing, you know, it seems... And all of that is based on this insane premise that your happiness lays somewhere out there. Mm-hmm. That's an absurd notion. Your happiness is here. This is where it is. If you think it's over there, what am I going to tell you? It's within you, your happiness. The thing that we all do the very best is enjoy. This is what we do the best. We enjoy. Of all the things you ever do, what you do the best is enjoy. Therefore, the more you enjoy, the more you are to live a life in tune.
Well, it's interesting. You were talking about getting that attention, and I think that could be traced maybe to a biological origin, like baby chicks that wah, 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 peep, 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 or whatever the little sound is, in order to be heard and fed. And the expression, the squeaky wheel gets greased, and all that. I do feel that is such an attention drain in our world.
Yeah. And those that don't require other people's attention are very likely to succeed greatly because they are not inhibited by a constant lack mentality. Once you get over other people's opinions of you, once you get over requiring approval, except for your own approval, I think 5 or 6 times in my life I've said to myself, we gotta have a talk. And that's just an internal dialogue, and that's because something appeared out of tune to me.
Yeah.
So then I had to be the one to fix that, because I, you know, this is this whole idea of the other person, this dependence upon, you know, everything within balance. I'm not saying, you know, I would ask for assistance, absolutely. But in general, if I can take care of it, I will.
Rendering assistance and seeing someone as your source are two different things. And that it's better to see things as the vehicle that is bringing you the things rather than them being the source. Like, for instance, it's not your boss or the paycheck that is the source of your money. It is just one of the vehicles. And when you open and expand it, your consciousness, you can start fitting a lot more things in there. Mm-hmm. But there are a lot of things that get us out of tune. The first foremost thing is our thinking, which I would say is the biggest thing that we have to deal with. And some of us are more active-minded people, and others of us are born a little more serene in the mind. But either way, you can make great headway with that.
Yes.
So if we think about getting out of tune, right now, think of having all the money that you can imagine and all the love that you can imagine, and you're getting ready to go on a round-the-world trip, and it's very exciting, and you could go wherever you wish to go. And you see the feeling of peace and calm and excitement that comes over you when you think of this. And now if I say, think of doing your taxes or paying your bills, or, well, paying my bills, I feel a great satisfaction with a lot of that. But think of something like driving to work or getting on the Beltway in the morning. And you notice how your energy field changes when you think of those two things. So this is a good idea to pay attention to how your thoughts are making you feel, because they will change your frequency like ringing a bell.
Well, so many of us are in this lockdown habit of being unhappy.
Yeah.
To the point that we magnetically draw out of the air something to make us unhappy. And then that makes us unhappy. And then actually being told that you're in the habit of being unhappy. You know, and so, not, you know, this is we, the human race, the group of us have gotten to the point that we don't understand how the operating system works. There isn't actually a functional evil out there behind things, because absolutely everything turns out to be love. And to recognize that, there's a search engine to play with, to recognize why whatever it is that appeared to be detrimental was actually on our side, because it always turns out to be on our side every time. It works that way.
Well, do you remember years ago we talked a lot about, and we've been doing this for 13 years now, so there are a lot of shows in the archives, and a lot of things we've talked about in years past we've just don't speak of a whole lot now because we talked about it a lot, but there are a lot of viewers that never saw our older shows. Mm-hmm. So one of the things we talked about a lot was when we start feeling bad, identify the thought that went to it, that is attached to it. Because I remember when I went through my depression, a really intense depression when I was younger, and I found that if I could trace it to something, then I could do something about it, and if mm-hmm. I couldn't trace it to something, then I could let it go because it wasn't important. And so I remember sitting, I worked two waitress jobs for a while, and in the afternoon I was rolling the silverware and doing all those tasks that you do after the lunch rush, and I was pondering, I was feeling this depression. I was saying, well, what is causing this depression? And instead of just getting wrapped up in the feeling, I used it as an opportunity to search my mind and say, mm-hmm. what is it? And I realized, well, there was this little event yesterday, and there was this thing that's due, and then there's this. And it was a conglomerate of a lot of different things, and I viewed it as a big pile of laundry. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't possibly put it all away in that big heap. So I would sort it and put the socks mm-hmm. over here, and then do something about each one of those. And I really feel when we get overwhelmed like that and depressed, it's because there are a lot of these little sparks going on in our thinking that then get our body's frequency down and not able to
get to that point.
Yeah, to figure out what's really bothering us.
Yeah.
We have
a minute ago you were saying that
doors opening and closing
our older shows, which were actually our younger shows.
That's true.
But we were younger, and they were younger.
Everything has another stream going the opposite way.
Now that is, there's always more than one correct answer about everything, and that's very much the point. A part of freeing ourselves, part of being in tune, is the acceptance of things. The grace is defined as the simplicity of being as a child receives life. Okay, well, that simplicity of being is a remarkable skill. It's Aikido per se. In other words, if whatever happened that my foot fell off, well, my foot fell off, you know, and you don't attach 100,000 things to that. It just fell off.
Well, in my inner wisdom deck, the description I have for grace has, in part, it says that it is the space of quiet between push and pull.
Excellent.
The space that's neither one.
Yeah.
It's right in the
and
center.
And that's very in tune. That mm-hmm. is actually a theme of our show this evening. So we had talked a little bit about how easily we are pulled out of tune, but it is constant. And the more out of tune you are, the easier it is to find something that puts you out of tune. So. But see, the whole thing is a massive irony, because the future always works out. There's no reason to ever question or believe or think that it won't work out, whatever it is that's annoying you. We had to use many times the example of the first bird in the morning that goes chirp, 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 okay, and this wakes you and you're very upset about that bird and you want to go and fricassee the bird, which has never really assisted the bird, but nonetheless, this concept. Now, the thing is, the bird is doing its job. Its job is to get up in the morning and announce that it's alive and that it's chirping and probably looking for either food or a mate or both. And your job then, at that time, is to be asleep. So you're pissed at the bird for doing its job, but the reality is you're upset with yourself that you're not doing your job. And that's, see, that is going in both directions at the same time.
Yeah, that's true.
And so once you go, okay, bird, I accept, I allow, and I surrender to the fact that you are cheeping or chirping first thing in the morning, and then you don't give it another thought, and you go right back to sleep. It's like diving into a pool.
That's one of the exercises I use in psychic development, where we're learning how to train the attention and to focus on things and not focus, and to gain mastery over your mind.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not saying that some people will find it very easy to master their mind in all kinds of different areas, but may have two or three spots where it's a very difficult thing. But the idea is to practice. And the thing about the birds is when they first come, you do hear them. Mm-hmm. And then you realize that there's nothing you can do about them, and they're not harming you. And so after a very short period of time, the birds are going like crazy out there, but you don't hear them anymore. It's because your attention has now been focused. Like, for instance, if you're staring at the television right now, you're not looking at the clock behind you or the refrigerator sound coming from your kitchen. It's not in your zone of awareness, but yet it is still there.
Yeah.
So much of our life is lived unconsciously. Mm-hmm. And so those refrigerator sounds, those things that we resist, become a point of imbalance within us. And so we're going to maybe talk about a number of things where we can get back into tune, things you can do in all different places and everything. But one thing that I thought would be useful to address is the idea of cell phones and electromagnetic fields from appliances and things that we plug in. Mm-hmm. We don't realize how many EMFs or electromagnetic field, that how much of a field just your lamp has emanating off of it. And our brain is an electromagnetic device, and it certainly gets affected by all of that. There's a lot of evidence to that, even if you need evidence to validate something for you. So one of the things that I suggest to people is to plug all your things into surge protectors, and then when you're not using it, unplug the surge protector, because just because your blender is off, you're still getting like 20 or 30% of the power is still going to the device. It's just not running it. And so you still have those EMFs. I have an electromagnetic field meter and a tri-field meter that shows the electromagnetics and coming off of devices, and the microwave was unbelievable, even when it was not running. And I even unplugged the microwave and could still pick up those EMFs, so I got rid of the microwave. It was just amazing. You will be able to think better, therefore your energy field will be better, by having less of an input. And sodalite is a stone you can use around your computer screen, and we talk about that to more depth in the opening of the third eye ceremony and in the crystal class. But there are a lot of things you can do.
The crystal class is coming up this weekend. If anyone is interested in come to the crystal class, 100,000 pieces of information will be passed,
and
not all
of
it verbally. Yeah, and you can. We have an extensive collection of assorted crystals and minerals, many of which you'll be holding. You've watched me week after week playing with a particular crystal. I don't know how much attention has been paid, but this crystal is remarkably clear from when we first brought it on the air. See that band right between my thumb and index finger is a what appears to be a fissure through the crystal, but it is gradually dissipating. Years and years ago, I had one that I thought would split just like that, and now you cannot tell where that occurred. We affect the crystals, and the crystals affect us. Come find out a lot about this. We have so much information on crystals, and I'm still stunned that people, you know, I would think everybody in the world would have a piece of quartz that is their pet. I thought pet rock was going to be the beginning of crystal consciousness for the human race, but it was, what is the word, turned into, monetized. It was monetized. It was never developed. It was turned into somebody's fat paycheck, but it was never brought to the potential
that
it could
be. Well, people don't realize that quartz crystals, piezoelectric crystals, which include amethyst as well, and fluorite even, that they are living beings. They actually grow. There's a DNA formatting that they grow with six sides, and that all of them have six sides, but they have their own unique personality. They're alive, and there's no mistake as to why they use quartz in watches and in computers to get that stream of oscillating energy that's necessary for that timekeeping and that precision. So when you hold something, the universe operates on the law of entrainment, which we're very much has to do with our subject tonight. So if you are holding a crystal that's vibrating at 32,000 hertz, then your body is going to entrain to a higher vibrational frequency. And the frequencies where you are literally other locations that hold higher thoughts, higher views on things. Mm-hmm. You said something really brilliant earlier, that when you're down in that place where you're viewing things as hurting you or against you or whatever, and that's all you can see from there. And that's true. You've all been experienced that when you're in a bad mood, quote unquote, and then everything around you just seems to be attacking you further. And when you're in a really good mood, then things all seem to be on your side. So the quartz can help elevate your body to that place where you see things differently.
Yes, if we could get everyone at a certain time to just hold a piece of quartz and think a particular thought, you know, no more government, you know,
well,
greater intelligence.
I think it could be more specific than that.
The idea of each of us remembering our individual power. We've said 100,000 times on this show many things, one of which is thought creates and where you place your attention grows. Drunvalo's quote, which is very much the principle that we're talking about. If you are out of tune and you place your attention on being out of tune, you are literally a magnet for something else that will knock you out of balance, knock you out of tune. It is the way it works. The anything you want to pick up on, you know, the Dulles Toll Road, we've heard about it. It's, oh, that's a German company. Oh, so we're exporting money to Germany. And then you're racing on this little thing and you're resentful and you're driving on roads instead of taking the convenience of the tollway. And all of those thoughts that you were thinking, what would you have been thinking if you weren't thinking those thoughts? What if, yes, so, it's so, it's, you know, there's always more money. So, this is of no consequence. What if that was your first search engine? This thing have you ever seen anything not work out? Come on, have you? No, it always works out. Do you think it's going to start not working out? So what percent of your life is spent out of tune? What percent of your life is spent thinking about how things won't work? Be honest with yourself. That is an uncomfortably large slice of pie graph, not the number thing. Okay. So the idea that the more you place your attention on that it's going to work out. I'm not worried about it. It's going to work out. It's always going to work out.
Don't worry, be happy.
Yeah, it's always going to work out. That's called being in tune. It's not going to work. That's called being out of tune. It comes down to it being that simple. Everything always works out. The belief that it won't work out is propaganda that's tattooed on us before we're even born. This idea that it isn't okay, that it isn't right. None of this stuff is actually real. What is real is that it's smooth. We've said countless times, please change the word future to the word trust. In the trust, everything will be fine. See how that works? In the future, everything will be fine. In the trust, everything will be fine.
Yeah, that's really quite a brilliant language code.
Yeah, trust the future, because it's never not worked out. It doesn't matter if you're struck by lightning. It still worked out because you went to heaven in a nanosecond. That's why. And I've been there. This is the way this works. The more you want to just sit back and relax, just sit back and relax. You want to drive, drive. If you don't want to drive, don't drive. You want to do this, do it. You don't want to do that, don't do it. Just relax.
Well, and it does make some people uncomfortable to do that. And because it does seem like, well, you have to prepare. And also there's the quote unquote evidence when people just stay playing video games and not getting out, getting a job and everything. Well, yeah, their life does not fall into place in the same way. There really is a balance point between participating in your life and responding and acting and doing things, but trusting that everything will be okay. We're still a vehicle for action and we're a vehicle of decision. And so I think that one clarifying thing with that is you make the decision and then you sit back. Years ago, I would hear let go and let God, and that made sense to me, and I would hear, oh, we create our own reality. But they seemed in opposition to me, and for years, I was like, okay, well, which is it? Which is it? And then one day it came to me, and how they got married together was, it's my job to say what, creating my own reality, but then it's the universe's job to say how, the let go and let God. Mm-hmm. So there has to be an interaction and there has to be a decision, because if you just allow things to unfold without decisions within your life, sometimes you'll it may look like you're not going anywhere, you're floating aimlessly, but even that is somewhere and it's teaching you something.
Yeah.
Well,
just one word before we go too far. As far as video games go, read a book called Ender's Game, Just read a book called Ender's Game. That's all I have to say about video games.
Oh, sounds like an interesting challenge. Well, shall we maybe start offering some suggestions? One of the things we've already said is your thought. And I remember saying, like, your highest possible thought, when we used to say that on the show. Where Neville always did
shows.
The snapping, when we were youngsters, snapping your finger. Once you identify, and I really think it's important for you to review what you're thinking. If you pay attention for 5 minutes of what goes on in your mind, you've pretty much got a direct map of what your next life is going to be like. Once you understand what's going through your head, you'll start understanding your beliefs, and then you can change them, and therefore change your reality. So pay attention to your thoughts as paramount, step number one. Number two is when you identify repetitive thoughts, and there are things that short circuit in our brain because of the electromagnetics and the microwaves and the cell phone waves and the radio waves and the whatever waves that cause us to get caught in loops in our brain. So we'll worry. The brain says, I'm in charge of everything. I have to fix everything. But the brain doesn't understand about tomorrow or things that it cannot see or understand. So it attempts to get a solution, can't find one, and so it starts back at square one and keeps going into this loop. So that's what we can interrupt, and that's what I think a lot of what Neville has presented over time with the snapping of the fingers is a brilliant thing to do. You're caught in that loop, I'm going to get laid off, blah, 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 and then you say, okay, I got to calm down. Then you go back to square one, but what about this? And you get caught.
Well,
snap your fingers and then reinitialize to something that is a higher frequency, like we were talking about earlier, the trip around the world, writing your book, whatever that is. And then everything looks different from there immediately.
Yeah, that is actually brilliant. Another search engine to apply is that since everything will turn out to be love, as soon as you have a big enough picture to understand what's going on, as soon as you can see what's going on, it turns out to be a form of love. It always does. The ancient Greeks, because they had a lot of togas and nothing to do, they sat around inventing words, and I can see how that was logical, especially given Animal House and the other toga pictures from the mid-80s. But the idea, they coined the word nemesis, and nemesis originally meant your best friend. Okay. Now, over the years, nemesis corrupted to mean someone that's out to get you, but that's not at all the truth of it. The nemesis, the person who's your best friend, is the one that shows you what you are unwilling to look at directly. And since we are so fragile here in the 21st century with all this stuff, or certainly appear to be fragile owing to the background material we're dealing with here, nemesis plays chaos with resistance. Nemesis plays chaos with resistance. In other words, the more you want to resist, the more chaos exists around you. But then again, you have to say that resistance is sort of a necessary part of reality, meaning that attraction can be called resistance. And to get someplace, therefore, so you see the conundrum nemesis would place you in, with your resistance. But there's a way to get traction without resistance, and that is by doubtless love. And as soon as you agree to approach the situation by presuming it to be love and then allowing yourself to recognize it, then the ascension, the advanced spirit, can arrive unchecked,
challenged?
Yeah, just by virtue of doubtless love about everything. Mm-hmm. This is absolutely the spirit lubricant that allows you to go through these situations that would have otherwise rendered you helpless and angry and just attracting negativity like a huge negativity magnet.
If there were such a thing. But
we've known these people.
Well, we've all had moments where
we've
attracted something at a lower frequency than what we would really truly desire to be having. But even that carries us to a higher place. But that is very true. I feel in our natural state, we're like Forrest Gump. We live our life, we love, we trust, and everything unfolds perfectly in front of us. Like Sweepy in the Popeye cartoons,
where
a little baby would be crawling out on steel girders and another steel girder will come and everybody's worried about the baby, but the baby's fine. I do feel that that is the natural order of things, and that
simplicity of belief.
I actually accomplished for about 3 weeks where I was able to attain a state of consciousness where I was living so fully in the moment, which is really the key. That's really what's going on. But I was living so fully in the moment that I was able to have this incredible state of bliss, but I wouldn't even call it bliss because I was not even measuring enough to be able to say, oh, I'm in bliss. It was a complete state of experience with no measurement. And I found that we're either measuring or we're experiencing, but we can't do both at the same time. Mm-hmm. And if you're measuring, you're not happy typically because you have to get out of the experience in order to judge it and measure it and compare it to flawed illusionary data in order to figure it out. Mm-hmm. Whereas if you're in the experience, and this is what people crave to become when they become artists or writers or to go live in a monastery and pray all day and that, is to be able to live in the moment. But what is so freeing and so wonderful is that we do all have access to it. Whether we can find it readily right now or not, it doesn't change the fact that it's there. And that's where the future being trust is great.
Yeah.
Well
as, yes. As this is a call-in show, if anyone is curious about it.
Okay, but maybe you could hold off for just a moment because I was going to ring the tuning forks. Is this a good time for everybody?
Yeah, good idea.
All right. Well, this is one way to get your body up into frequency. We talked about thought. But since radio frequency and microwaves and electromagnetic fields take your, and even riding in the car and jostling around or having a fight or listening to the news, any of that lowers your frequency. Well, these are emanations of vibration that come into your body. So there are a lot of vibratory things that you can do from within your body and outside of your body in order to get yourself back in tune. And we have been having bowls on the show for well over a decade, probably going on 2 decades
now.
Yeah,
we were one of the first to ever
probably,
come up with bowls.
Yeah, probably the first one that ever did bowl events. And
area.
A lot of people are doing them now, which I think is wonderful in that this is getting spread all over the place. Mm-hmm. But that really does upgrade your and get you back in tune. And we're doing one this weekend, by the way. But I'm going to ring 7 tuning forks and a few minutes with each one. And I will be recording these and putting them in meditation break on iTunes for people to download and listen to. But I would invite you to close your eyes if you choose and allow these vibrations to go into your body and entrain your field up to its natural frequency. And maybe I could get feedback to make sure that's going out okay. So this is the base chakra.
Well, I can hear it from the fork. I assume it's going over the air.
Okay, I will trust then that that's going out. Now this next note is the note D, and it's your sacral chakra, which is at a couple of inches below your belly button.
Sounds like it.
And the next one is the note E. This is your solar plexus, and it's the matters of the mind and of territory. And your personal power. The next note is note F, and it's the heart chakra, and this is the matters of the emotions, the heart, love, This is the note G, and it's the throat chakra, communication and creativity, and also your boundaries. This is the note A, and it's the third eye, and this is the vision that you hold for yourself, the seeing into the trust instead of the future. Mm-hmm. This is the crown, which is the note B. Connection to the higher things. Okay.
Oh, excellent. Thank you very much for doing that.
Sure, my pleasure.
Now, as this is a live call-in show, if you were here to pick up the phone, the number's on the screen all the time. And just give us a call in with anything that we may assist you to understand as love, to assist you to tune to it, to get you to see a higher perspective on everything that's going on in your life, everything that's going on, period. Give us a call. We're right here, we're standing by, and we've been doing this for ever so many years. And also, as we said, we're doing the crystal class coming up in this weekend, this Sunday, we're doing the crystal class, and also Saturday night.
It's the meditation night. But we're also going to be doing, this is property and uses, and a little while out we're going to do healing with crystals about laying on with stone, mm-hmm. and how to have a healing kit and how to incorporate that into your practice of energy healing or whatever mm-hmm. else. And then we also have following that, advanced gridding techniques, which are really powerful. So if you are familiar with crystals, you know how wonderful that can be. Well, and then the tarot practicum is coming up as well.
Oh, excellent, excellent. So I've been painting once again, and I've done, this is the vegan skull and crossbones, because I feel that if you're vegan, you deserve some sort of
scary icon.
Yes, well, that would be the whole point. And that is a mushroom, by the way, that's smiling at you. And across celery sticks, what else would you use, come to think of it? And one of the things about vegan is that it's surprising the number of people that claim that they're vegan who are not at all from the star system Vega. And where they get this idea, I don't know, but nonetheless. So this concept of being aware, I totally love to paint. This is a great passion for me. I did a show a couple of months ago that illustrated any number of paintings, and I've done quite a few in the interim time period. So there's another one about to come up, and I don't remember what it was, but I remember bringing something in.
You've brought many, because you bring two pretty much to every show, and then you've done a show with them on, but they're all in the archives if people would like to go have a look.
Yeah, and the way
this
in which
wonderful.
And here's the other one just while we do all this stuff. Mm-hmm. And take two, there we go. Oh yeah,
there
the crabula. This is a labyrinth with a crab, so it's a crabulent.
You know what it reminds me of? Do you remember when we made a labyrinth? I like to draw labyrinths on the sand on the beach and then walk them mm-hmm. while I'm on the beach, which is really powerful. We did it one time, and a little crab poked its head up right in the center of our labyrinth. Mm-hmm. So that's what it reminds me. Maybe that was even your inspiration, but it's really lovely.
Yeah, so the crab, it's a pastel 22 by 30 minus an inch all the way around.
Now,
it's actually 20 by...
You had mentioned that there was also the Mayan pyramid from above.
Yeah, it does look like a Mayan pyramid, which was a byproduct of my catching the light going over the crab shell, and it just turned three-dimensional. I thought that was
it's really lovely, Neville.
Yeah, really exciting.
I really like that. That's stunning.
Yeah, me too. The thing worked really well.
All of your paintings are. I just look at them and say, wow, every day.
There's a lot more to come.
And I am in the hopper of my many projects is getting you a website with all of your artwork that's really important. Well, thank you for that. And I would say your art and art in general lifts the frequency up. So it's another thing you can do to stay in tune. It tunes you to who you really are.
Yeah.
But also, affirmations do the same thing. Mm-hmm. And how they work is if you think about your thoughts that have running in your head about how flawed you are all the time, like, oh, my thighs, oh, blah, 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 I'm not this, I'm not that, it lowers your frequency.
Mm-hmm.
So saying affirmations right now, anytime while you're sitting in traffic, but especially as you go to bed, because then you go into a state of hypnosis.
And as you wake up.
And as you wake up in that place right there. So I was going to suggest, and then maybe you could suggest one. We've come up with just literally hundreds and hundreds over the year in our Consciously Creating Your Life class, where we get affirmations for people, which we are going to offer some version of that on the show soon. But one is, I love and accept myself unconditionally. So if everyone would say that three times out loud right now, I love and accept myself unconditionally.
I love and accept myself unconditionally.
I love and accept myself unconditionally.
I love and accept myself
unconditionally. And what that does is the harmony or the vibration of those words actually entrains your field up to that, because our words, as you teach on so many levels, but what I have also said for many years is that there's a vibration that the words ride on that have, it's a carrier wave. And so by saying certain things, this wave can entrain your body up to its natural
And you can
frequency.
Change your reality by changing the way you think, by changing the words you think in, by just agreeing to change your reality. It is, there's one word that seems to elude the human race, and that is the word decision. It's not about can you do it, it's about will you decide to do it. It's not about the ability, it's about the decision. It's not about the circumstance, it's about the decision. It's not about anything other than the decision. If you will decide and not doubt, you have to not doubt. Oh, there it went, didn't it? Now come back here. No, you just decide and then you allow. This is not complex. It's not.
Our job to say what? The universe's job to say how.
Exactly, yeah.
Well,
so just make a decision about your life. Don't think about it. And a month from now, or whatever that is, there it is. Yeah, I don't know why this seems to be such a elusive to we the humans.
Well,
but it does seem to be.
I mean, we have to just go through what we go through, and we get where we're getting. There's no finish line, and there's no race, and we're all going to end up being, you know, ultimately, we're always where we're best to be anyway, so even that is good. Well, another thing that is really good is chanting, which is like an affirmation, but you say it more musically. And the thing about doing something musically or rhythmically is it accesses all kinds of aspects, all parts of your brain, but also opens up meditative and spiritual centers within yourself. And I have found that when you chant something that is in a different language, and in some of my Master Healing series, I teach some very special chants for specific things. It's good that it's in a different language, because right now, if we say, I am love, I am light, I am peace, I am love, I am light, I am peace, it's really wonderful. But when you have things attached to peace, and peace makes you think of war and all this, that it may have a different harmony, but the pristine version of the word carries a high frequency. So that's why getting mantras and chants that are in other languages can be very beneficial, because you don't have any mental tie to them. And the actual word and the meaning behind the word comes through very pristine and not through your filter. Mm-hmm. So chanting is really good. And when I was young, I think everybody, tell me if you have had this, where you have your own specific tune. And I've taught people in the past how to find your own tune, your own harmony. And that is something you can use to pull yourself back into center.
Well, man is the only animal that doesn't have a specific sound.
I know, that's why I came up with that tune that we all have. And kids have a tune, they're just born with that one, even in other languages.
Kids, and then they turn into adults. How does that happen?
Well, perhaps you could share doing the vowels and how powerful that can be.
I'd have to stand up, but I guess I can do it sitting. The vowels are an unbelievable. Maybe you can do do, re, mi after
okay,
that.
Well, so yeah, I have it down to
tuning,
do that.
This is a technique of tuning that's unparalleled, and it's not for the faint of heart, so run now if you're the faint of heart. So the vowels are very sacred sounds, and they've been belittled as much as possible in our by our culture, by our language. The vowels alone will bring a dynamic force into you.
Well, in Sanskrit, so, the vowels are calling spirit. That's how spirit communicates.
Yeah, and the Hebrew language, when written, has the vowels taken out because they're too sacred to have written, mm-hmm. because then somebody might be able to intone what was mm-hmm. going on.
This is true.
So, as we know, the vowels are A, E, I, O, and U is mispronounced. It's actually Hue, H-U-E, short for human. We are beings of color. We are Hue men and women. Yes, we are Hue beings, human beings, okay? So you pronounce the U, Hue, okay? So you stand up, and the reason I'm not is I'm mic'd into the chair here. So you stand up very straight, stand up now in front of the TV, and you put your arms to your side, and you blast A. A, E, I, O, U. Yes, that would have been better in that, straight on that camera, but that, nonetheless.
That was so good though,
yeah,
because you're literally throwing this A, E, I, O, U. Yeah. Into your field, and it just breaks up things.
Let me do this once more. Could we have the camera straight on?
So you want camera
three?
Hi.
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay. A, I, O, you touch the hands. You. Now, if someone upsets you anywhere in your life, stand up and do that, looking at them. They will never again come near you because you have demonstrated you have knowledge and power that is vastly beyond them and the petty game they wish to play. This is an unbelievable excitement to run this through your body. You'd be out of tune about anything you want to be out of tune about, and just do the vowels and bang, there you are. You're back in tune.
And it's a beautiful thing to do. And it's a really good thing to release anger, to remove blocks from your life.
Yeah.
And real quick, I know we're getting set up for the duck. I wanted mm-hmm. to also introduce the do, re, mi.
Yes, do the do,
and
re, mi.
The do, re, mi is essentially you're doing the C scale, which is what we do with the bowls and everything mm-hmm. else. But mm-hmm. it's like tuning yourself from the inside out. So you can use a tuner to make sure your do is the right note.
Do.
It just goes do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. But when you do it really powerfully where you can feel it vibrating in your bass chakra. Do, you know, the do, mm-hmm. re,
mi.
And in each chakra. And it's so powerful. I've done it in the car when I felt out of tune or when I felt upset about something.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm immediately pulled back to
yes.
calmness and tune. Okay, we've got the duck.
Do
well,
duck.
At least we got a lot of that in.
Very.
And then, of course, there is music.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of tune.
That was fun.
Mm-hmm. And here's our dangler extraordinaire.
Okay.
Volunteer this evening.
Inspiration.
Vision.
So instead of expirating it, you inspirate it.
Mm-hmm.
So you're breathing it in. So inspiration is.
Yes.
You're inhaling mm-hmm. something and letting it turn into something else, and it can exhale it as your work of art, for
yeah.
instance.
And I got vision, and the eyes version of being out of tune is being out of focus. So you can just, that's another thing you could do with the vowels or a do, re, mi, is to focus, just to practice, look at something. We are constantly in front of a computer screen or some iPad call it? Retina enhanced, something like that. No, there's
know.
This constant.
Any of those new terms you got to look out for.
Yeah, no, they're not quite what they're supposed to be. Nonetheless, you can focus your eyes powerfully through the either do, re, mi, or the vowel sounds. Could choose to do that.
Sure, that'd be great.
That would suggest a mountaintop to do it on.
Well, definitely true, and I have done that out in nature, and it's just extremely powerful. One thing I would also suggest to our viewers is that in the archives on YouTube, and you can get to them via our website, Telepathic TV, and you can also listen to it on iTunes, but this might be a good one to watch. We did a three-part series on transforming energy a while ago, and it has drumming, it has... pretty much everything that you can think of to transform your energy, all the way from things that you think and exercises. So anyway, it's Transforming Energy Part 1 and 2. I don't know what's going on with the cameras here, but...
That's okay. Okay. And we have our caller. Hi, caller. What's your name, please?
My name is Bea. Hello. I enjoy your show. May I have a reading, please?
Sure.
Oh, thank you very much.
Sure. I'd be happy to. I didn't know if
Mary's using the decks she's authored here, by the way.
No, one of them is the Osho Zen, the really beautiful one, and the others are ones I drew. It's with an older art program, but the writing that I do that go along with these cards is really the main focus. I developed these so people could have something to play online. Mm-hmm. But they are available in physical form, too. But I've got other decks coming up soon, too. The first card we get is the Breakthrough card, and this is talking about sometimes we have breakdowns and other times we have breakthroughs, and that this whatever has happened in your past has made you stronger and made you break out of old molds. Like sometimes people will lose a job, get laid off from a job, just so that they can get out there in the world and get out of that cage that they had been in. So everything is a blessing, and seeing it that way is really perfect. This is the card of friendship, and all friendship is being close enough, just like in the friendliness card. I'd never equated the two. But it's being friends with yourself first, because if you can't be friends with yourself, then the people that you harmonize with you won't be friends with you either. And it's very evident when that happens. Then we've got the little raccoon. And the raccoon, Neville and I have quite a relationship with raccoons, and they're really adorable, and they clean everything. They clean everything, and they're always looking off in another direction. And I feel like what this is saying is that maybe there is a friendship that you've had that now might be the time to call somebody that you haven't talked to. And maybe there wasn't a fight or anything, but that you've drifted apart, and it's time to get it back together. And maybe even a sister or a family member. And I just see communication like that would be a good thing.
That's
so thank
excellent.
You.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And do we have another caller? Hi. Hi, caller. What's your name, please?
Hi, yes, this is Judy.
Hi, Judy.
What can we do for you?
Hi, yeah, I wanted to get a reading from Mary, if I could, and also I wanted to tell you how much I've enjoyed the show. I took one of your dream workshops quite a few years ago.
Oh, well, it's nice to hear from you.
Yeah, but thank you very much. I'll go ahead and hang up.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, thanks for calling in.
Yes, thank you very much. And let's see what we get here. First card we get. This is a card that talks about compromise, and we always think of compromise as a good thing. I'll give up half, you give up half, and then we all can be part of this team. But really the message of this card is sometimes it's not the best thing to compromise, where everybody gets something watered down and nothing's really growing, nothing's really becoming substantive. So it's saying that if you look at things from the perspective that everybody can win instead of that I have to compromise, you're going to find all kinds of options and solutions open up. And it could be talking about a situation that you found yourself in that you know now that, hey, there are certain things about myself I'm not ever going to compromise again, and I don't have to fight about it. And that's so liberating. The door opens because there is opportunity. And so opportunities are showing up in your life today. I would say look back into the past and say, what did those other situations that are like this teach me about this? And then walk through the door. And you'll feel empowered then. And then the last card is the dolphin. And the dolphin reminds us to follow our own rhythm. The dolphins have this beautiful rhythm where they go under the water, hold their breath, and come up and breathe. And it's just so graceful and so beautiful. We have our rhythm too. And this is like the subject of tonight's show. We get thrown out of our rhythm because we have to eat at this time, we have to sleep at this time.
Rhythm and tune.
Find your rhythm. Find your rhythm with that and don't compromise it. And opportunities like you wouldn't believe will open up. Because adapting too much actually keeps things at arm's length at times.
Fine tune. Thank you. This expression just occurred to me. Fine your tuning.
Yep, find your tuning.
Hi, caller. What can we do for you?
Hi, you're on the air.
Hi, this is Edith.
Hi, Edith.
Edith, hey, how are you doing?
Good, how are you?
Good.
I'm calling for a reading from Mary, and I'm going to hang up.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for calling.
All right. Let's see here. Okay, the first card that we get is the isolation. Emotion is like water, and it flows until it hits upon something that stops it, like a wall. And the only other way, if you don't have a wall, is for water to freeze, but yet then that's not in our natural flow. So it's saying, let the rainbow tears of our passion melt away the ice that we have had. I feel like there is a thawing going on, just on a heart level for you, that is opening up new opportunities. And I actually see somebody coming into your life that might be really significant, or a deepening of something romantically. The breather card is saying sometimes too, rather than swimming the currents or fighting the currents, just sit down, relax, put your feet up, and not worry about it. Trust the future, as we've been saying all night. Mm. And the bee is about going and pollinating the flowers of life with love, and see what develops, the honey that you can extract from that. And it's going out there. You have to be courageous enough or open to get out of the safety zone and go out there and network with people and be out there with people. So I think even if we had read these backwards, it might have even made more sense. It's saying go out there and network. Well, no, actually, the melting has to happen before the other stuff happens. So anyway, it does feel like there is a new love coming into your life. So
yeah,
thank you.
Totally excellent.
All right.
Hi, caller. What's your name, please?
Hi, you're on the air.
Hello.
Hi.
Oh, hi, wonderful. Good evening. My name is Isabel, and I would like a reading with Mary, please.
I'd be happy to.
Thank you for calling.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Mm-hmm. I love that name. It's so
Isabel.
Beautiful.
Isabel. Yeah, Bell means beautiful to begin.
Yeah.
It's beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and bells are like music to our ears, too. So.
Mm-hmm.
And there are all kinds of beautiful things there. So let's see. The first card we get, it's saying going with the flow. And what's really wonderful is to know that we have designed the riverbed. And so even if things don't look like it's going in the direction we wished it to go into, and we're fighting and we're swimming upstream, the thing is that we design the river. So get in touch with the part of us that has designed the river and redesign it rather than fighting the currents. So it is saying that I really do feel that over the course of your life, you've gotten more and more just going with the flow, but that sometimes you might think, oh, am I taking care of myself? Am I doing everything, or am I just being too passive? And it's saying, no, you're doing the right thing. This fertile ground is really interesting. You can see coins and food and all kinds of things are under the surface there, even though it may not look like it at the top. So finances are really improving as well, even though it doesn't look like it. That this is a time where there really is a harmony around you with money. And this is not typically stuff I suggest people to do, but occasionally I get this feeling to tell you to go ahead and buy a lottery ticket, because this is the kind of energy that goes around that. And then this is about introspection and going within, but I feel like it's telling you to look closely at something right now. And it's not in a dangerous way or anything like that, like you're not going to miss something. It's just saying that you could really profit from looking at the details right now of some kind of an agreement. So anyway, and it doesn't have to be an agreement, it could be something broader, and I know we're getting down to our last few minutes, so thank you for calling.
Yeah. Hi. Do we have another? We're all set. Okay. Well, this is a very good show this evening on the idea that it is within your purview, it is within your ability, to call yourself into tune. We've spoken many techniques by which you can realign yourself. And the more you are in tune, the more you will enjoy your life. The more you enjoy your life, the more advanced a being you become. And that is the principle that we're talking about in the advanced worlds, which we rarely speak of, but still exist, worlds beyond our own, occupied by humanoids. The whole point is the enjoyment of life. There's very little in the way of entertainment in other worlds, because everybody's quite happy with what their life is. And the only reason Hollywood exists in its present form is nobody's happy with the way things are.
That's true. It really made a big, when it really made a big upstroke was during the Depression. You're right.
Yeah, and not only that, World War II, and Hollywood was set. Nobody wanted to be where they were or do what they were doing. Everybody wanted the escape. And if that wasn't true, there wouldn't be this mm-hmm. whole concept. So mm-hmm. if you want to get even, if you want to get beyond conspiracy, enjoy your life.
That's good.
That
good. I agree with that 100%.
Yeah.
Good advice to give.
Yeah.
Well, it's our joy and honor to take you to the door. Check out the website telepathictv.com, maryphelan.com, and pretty soon to be ourneville.johnston.com, but that's not ready yet. So we will talk soon.
Uplifting your spirit.